Hello, my name is David Ichim. I'm a software engineer at AutoWeb. I'm currently working for EEA, European Environmental Agency. And I want to talk today about high-performing and maintainable Plone themes, or at least how I'm going to tell you about them in the 40 short minutes that I have. So, what a question I'm going to start first. Why do we need our theme to be performant? And if we look at a couple of reasons, one of them would be that Google now has more mobile search queries done than desktop queries. And if we think about it, this is quite a big deal because everybody's using Google, and now everybody's using, I mean, people are flocking to using Google on mobile. And mobile traffic, it comes with various resolutions, with various internet connection speeds, and we need to take care of them. If we look at the cost of internet around the world, we can see that unless you're like in Romania or USA or something like that, internet is going to be expensive for you. And we don't want to send so much information to people that we will just build them up with their 3G bill because our site is loading everything when they wouldn't need it. So how do we make a performance theme? I mean, if we think about it, it requires many different skills and steps, and sometimes you just feel like, I'm thinking of Pi. But if we look at why do we need our theme to be performant, we see that we, at least how I thought about it, we have three aspects that we can clearly think about. First of all, we need to, when we think of how to build our performant theme, we need to cater to different aspects of the site for different users. I mean, we can have a mobile view, you know, or people that view us on mobile, or people that view us on a tablet. Then we have our content editors, and then we have, obviously, our anonymous users. And each of these users have different issues that we need to think about, and we need to measure our key site performances. And when we think about the size of the traffic that we're sending, the speed with which our site loads, how heavy is it, and how powerful, how easy, how animated is it? And we need, in order to keep it performant, I thought that we need to have our theme and our site documented. We need to have it easily maintainable. In order to maintain it well, you're going to have to enforce some rules that people will need to follow, because obviously in any site that is a small, you're going to have more than one developer, more than one designer, and if you have a common style, then it's going to be a lot easier for everybody to work without stepping on each other's toes. And we need to be able to test our changes, and we're going to see how in the next slides. So my talk has 4 points. I thought about what do we need to do for a performance theme? We need to measure it, we need to optimize it, we need to document it, and we need to monitor it. And let's quickly go through all of these steps because I have quite a few slides and I'm afraid I won't finish on time. So first of all, let's measure it. And if you think about it, nowadays we have so many tools and we can start using even the most simple ones, like the performance audit from Google Inspector Tools. We can select the network utilization and web page performance. Immediately, we have some red flags and some yellow flags that we can quickly see not only what the problem is, but the tool will give us even suggestions on how to fix them. And then we can move on to more intermediate tools, such as like Google PageSpeed Insights. It's still kind of the same from the audit, but you have also a speed index, which you can check both for mobile view or for desktop tool view. And now we can move on to more advanced tools, such as the web page test tool. And it gives you, if we go through the details, the performance review, it will tell you a lot of things that go wrong about your site. And I made the test of a simple Plone site. First of all, my case study will start with a simple Plone site with Sunburst installed. And exactly what Plone is doing bad from the beginning without any optimization added to it. And if we look, we have a lot of failing grades. So after, if we look at all of these tools, we can clearly see that what they're trying to say is that you should aim for like high scores and low loading times. Because if we look, 63 is clearly not a good number. You want to get as close to 100 as possible. And with just 15 minutes of optimization, or just doing whatever the tools told me to do, I got from 63 to 90, and I'm on the green already. I can do a couple of small fixes and then move on and do other things. So now that we have our benchmark, now that we measured and we saw what we need to do, we can start on the next path, which is to optimize it. And a small context, we work on a Plone 4.3 site. We don't use Diazo. So most of the things that I'm going to talk about, it's going to be in the context of having a classical theme, not with Diazo. I do have some Diazo advice, but in general, all of this performance is thought for a Plone 4 site with a classic theme. First big thing we can do, we can upgrade jQuery to the latest 1.x version. Plone 4.3 ships with 1.7.2, which is bad for performance. We had some animation on a mobile view, and it was really jaggy. And as soon as I tested, let's see how it looks with the newest version of jQuery, I got rid of all of that jagginess. And if you're going to follow this blog post, you will see that they got rid of a lot of layout paints that they were doing in previous versions of jQuery. How can we upgrade in a Plone 4.3 site? Very easy. We add two pins. We load the development profile of plone.update.jQuery because we need the jQuery migrate plugin as well. And that's about it. And the reason why we need the jQuery migrate plugin, because we still have bad code in a Plone 4.3 site. We have code that uses browser detection. We have code that uses live and stuff like that. We don't want to break it. We can add the jQuery migrate plugin. They will give us the warnings. We can fix them. And at one point, we can get rid of jQuery migrate plugin. But until then, we can actually add the plugin inside and have all of this performance right now and worry about fixing all of those legacy issues if we must. Or we can upgrade to Plone 5, and by then, we won't need to do it. So another thing that we need to do is, if we look at the slides and what they were complaining about when we did the performance audit, we're loading a lot of JavaScript in the head, and JavaScript will block the rendering of the content. As such, they advise us to move the JavaScript from the head. And we can do, first of all, the easiest thing, load jQuery, only jQuery in the head. And we can do it two ways. We can use a CDN and load jQuery, or even better, we can only use jQuery DOM ready, which is actually really good because most of the time, either way, we're wrapping our code in DOM ready, and all we really needed from jQuery was the DOM ready functionality. And if we look at main template, we can easily just insert jQuery. Or we can insert only the jQuery plugin. Adi Osmani pulled the DOM ready script from jQuery 1.8.3, and instead of having 117 kilobytes, we have only, I don't know, 5 kilobytes, which give us the DOM ready functionality from jQuery. So another thing, I mean, if we're going to measure that performance, yeah, it's going to be a little bit better, but the fact that we keep jQuery in the head will still give us the warning that we have the JavaScript in the head and we are blocking the site. So we need to consider moving the JavaScript then out of the head in order to avoid this render blocking. If you have Diazo, great, it's really easy. You just add this tag and it will move all of the script tags from the head to the body. And that's really powerful and easy to do. If you want to move it through main template, there are quite a few more steps involved. First of all, you need to customize resource registries. You need to remove the line that will actually load the scripts. You need to customize main template. You need to also move JavaScript head slots to the bottom of the body page and also the resource registries. Because if we keep the JavaScript head slots, especially in the edit, there's a lot of widgets which insert themselves in JavaScript head slot, and you will probably run into situations where they're calling code that will not be there now that we move everything to the bottom. And we can clearly see here that all I had to do was have these two scripts at the end of the body tag, and now everything will load at the end of the body. As soon as I did this, you know, we made a change. We need to test it and see what impact it has. And the score went from 70, 60 something to 72. And we got rid of one thing that the page speed tool complained to us. Now, if we move the JS to the body, we will have side effects. We might run into situations where we have flash of unstyled content. And I was doing a test for the EA site, for instance, and we had a jQuery gallery. And obviously, the jQuery gallery was doing a lot of DOM manipulation, which you didn't see it when you had the JavaScript rendering. And now that it's moved, you see everything in really in an unstyled way. So if we're quick loading, means that people also will get to see a lot of the things that you might have wanted to keep them in the back end, you know, and that rendering blocking was actually being your friend. And there are some things that you can do to minimize this, or you need to think about this situation. If you have a gallery and you know it's going to show some things, hide it, put a spinner on it, and just show it when it's done its transformation. And that way you mitigate this flash of unstyled content. The problem is there isn't a one silver bullet solution. You have to test on your site and see exactly what happens whenever you move the JavaScript to the bottom and then see what needs to be fixed. Maybe some transformations you don't need to do with JavaScript and you can just use it for what it was intended, but still have a lot of the structure in there already and have it nicely themed with CSS. So another side effect could be that random JavaScript could break. If we move everything, I don't know, we might have some code which randomly in the page assumes that jQuery is there. And here, we probably could mitigate this if we insert a DOM ready script in the head. Again, giving them the ability to call when the DOM is ready. And this has actually been discussed as an issue in CMF Plone that we should consider by now to move the JavaScript to the bottom. And I think with solutions like this, something could be done already. So now that we dealt with the JavaScript, another issue that we had was that we're not gzipping, and we're not compressing the resources that we're shipping to the users. Really easy thing to solve, install Plone app caching, enable gzip compression and caching. And again, as soon as you do that, measure again and see what performance difference it made. And we can clearly see I went from 72 to 83 by simply adding an add-on and enabling it. So now we got rid of the gzip compression, but the tool is still complaining about us having too many styles that we're loading and will cause a delay. We should consider merging all of these rules. And we need to, first of all, how do we do this? When portal CSS or portal JavaScript, we need to inspect the merge composition. And we need to arrange our resources in order to have a minimal number of these compositions or requests. And we need to think then when we do so, maybe we can remove styles in JavaScript that our site simply doesn't use. If we look at the default Plone sunburst, we can see right off the bat that we have a couple of bundle breakers or composition breakers. We have the members, which is loading, which is simply loading after the reset. All of the other styles, we'll need to go in another composition simply because of this member. And then we have some styles which are actually empty. We don't even need them there. And we could remove them to just avoid having that extra merging of nothing. Then we can clearly see we have another bundle breaker here with the date input. And lastly, we have Plone custom, which, yeah, it's custom, therefore you think you should put it last. I've done a few modifications, and here's what a clean resource could look like. I mean, if we look, all I've done was move the restricted to authenticated CSS, one bundle, have all of the anonymous in another bundle, and then any other conditions on their own. And I've done that, and now the anonymous site only loads one CSS. And again, my score jumped from 82 to 89, and I'm on the green. So a little change made a big impact. But if we still, if we would look, we still have some images which we are actually serving, but we have no cache for them. And we need to think of dealing with the static content cache. You can import the content strategy cache from plone.app.caching. And we need to add the images that should have a long cache to the strong cache policy. And if I'm not mistaken, actually, the strong policy cache does have the setting to expire in 1 year. And as I was running those tools, I saw, you know, the logo, the spinner, the favicon, they had really low cache, like 1 day or something like that. The favicon isn't going to change every 1 day, or the spinner. It's going to be there. So look for images that, you know, are going to expire, I mean, are long-lived, and set them to a really high cache. So after I made these changes, except the first byte, which is still F because I'm actually having a survey in Europe and I was testing in Dallas. I went from D's and F's to A's with just a couple of changes. If I would have made the test somewhere in Europe, that first byte would have been given a bigger mark. So now that we made those optimizations that the tools told us, we can make further optimizations. We need to think that we need to optimize our CSS and optimize our JavaScript. A couple of tools to do so, first of all, would be to use something like CSS Lint. And as it clearly states in the site, if you run it, it's going to hurt your feelings. And really, just by running the stock sunburst, we got 555 warnings. I don't even want to imagine how many warnings it's going to give if we run Barcelonata, maybe actually even less, because as I was looking, Barcelonata is more using a more modern approach where we have, we're using a lot more classes and we're not styling IDs and stuff like that. Some of these rules are really hard to apply, like don't style IDs at all. And it might be too hard given your stack, but some of them make sense, and I'm gonna go back to that in a second. Another tool that we can use, it's called style stats. And if you add just the URL, it will tell you the stat for the entire CSS. But you can also pass it just those CSS bundles, and it will give you statistics to those files individually. If we look, like we have with Sunburst, the most identifiers are 7. Why do we need like table listing, tbody, tr, or dragging, I don't know, th, whatever was there, you know, when you probably just needed just the th? And if you look, it's going to give you a lot of statistics about the CSS. Like we're using 29 important keywords, which means at least in 29 situations, you're going to end up having to override that important again. And these tools can help you get a bird's eye view of the situation of the styles of the site. And you should aim to improve as many things as possible. So if I advise you to check out this article, it's telling you about cyclomatic complexity in the CSS. And basically, it's arguing that this selector, it's like having 7 if statements in Python. You won't do 7 ifs to get to a point. You would target something a lot more specific. And since CSS, it's read from right to left, all of these, they're just if statements, when all you care about is what was there, like the th. And if the th had a good class, or you could have just had like dragging th, you know, and it would have been one if statement, and then the selector you actually care about. So you need to think of CSS as something that is hard to maintain, and you need to make it as easy as possible for you by following some guidelines that you would be following if you were programming. You know, you want to keep functions as simple as possible, and you should aim to make your CSS as simple as possible. So now that we looked at optimizing Java CSS, we can look at optimizing JavaScript. And I found this tool with this funny picture, Fantomas. It's an OJS plugin, and it has a lot of things that will check for you. You can specify many flags. For instance, I've said I only care about the CSS and no externals for the CSS. I don't care about, I don't know, Font Awesome or what else we might be using. I only wanted to get a bird's eye view of how we're doing. And you're probably not going to see very much from the slides, and whatever is there is not even important. I just wanted to show you that it gives you a crazy amount of details, like what you're using, what jQuery is using to have a DOM write, what jQuery is reading, what's triggering events. It's something that you need to look at and see if you need to remove them or optimize them. So now that we went to the monitor and optimization step, we can go to our third step, which is to document our theme. So for the first step in documenting our theme, I thought of style guides. And yeah, we have some questions like, why do we need a style guide in the first place? And how might we go about creating a style guide or automating it? And then if we automate, we need also to maintain, which goes kind of hand in hand with the automation. If we look, Eric Steele added an issue where like we need a style guide for Plone core. We have various inconsistencies, and we need to document and have one way of of having all of our components or casing. You know, a style guide can be very broad. It can be strictly only about the way you write the CSS, or it can be about the elements on the site. It's very broad. In this case, Eric needs consistency in the design. So why do we need a style guide? As I said, we need it because we need to have a living documentation of visual code. And it helps us provide a one-stop place for anybody on the team to reference it when a design element is needed. A style guide, it's going to go hand in hand with an editor that will use the site. And if you provide a style guide in the site, then it's going to help them whenever they need elements that they can actually add on the site, kind of like with the patterns library. So we need it because we want to provide consistency when the system is made up of several components and they're all made by different teams. If we look at the way Barcelonata was made, we can see that there was actually a style guide made, and it helped Alberto or whoever wrote it to document and have all of the elements that are now in Plone. So how might we go about creating a style guide? There's two ways. You can use a style guide generator with automatic or manual templating, and I'm going to explain in a second what that means. Or you can just create the manual page template and use it as your style guide. Here are some style guides generators. I tried a couple of them. I think you should check them out, especially if you're interested in style guides and it's something that you want to use in your organization. But I quickly found some disadvantages of these automated style guides. First of all, they're made with different languages, and sometimes you might not be able to install Ruby or PHP or Node.js. Node should be more accessible now that everybody's using it. But anyway, only some tools will make a template out of the commented markup. And I say this because I found that like document CSS will not make any templates. It will just copy the CSS, but you have to also provide the markup that will style that CSS, which I found strange. So because they're made by these external tools, they usually have this workflow where, I don't know, they're either static or they're placed somewhere, and obviously will not load the site CSS by default. And they also provide some templates, which again you will need to style. And you need to spend a lot of time configuring them because some of them do not come with good defaults. And as I was saying, they will not integrate your site styles unless you specifically tell them. So sometimes you might be testing the wrong things and you don't know how CSS from the site would actually affect even the style guide. And as I was preparing for this talk, this is what came out of Hologram. It's really ugly. And so I gave up on the automated CSS for now. And I said, okay, let's use a manual style guide at least. We can have a page template that is added within the site that anybody can use or check. At EEA, we have EEA. Let me show you. Code design elements. This is our style guide accessible by anybody. And we have a bunch of things that editors can use, developers can use. They can see what common design elements we have in the site, and it's helpful for everybody. Okay, so you can have this manual page template, and you can still think about automating the rendering of code examples. For instance, Plone has test rendering. We can use test rendering because it does have some style elements, and we can automate it a little bit. We can use this plugin from Filament Group called X-Ray, and it can also be used with some other JavaScript that can provide syntax highlighting for the templates. This is the URL for this JavaScript. Basically what it does, it's really simple. It allows you to wrap any block content that you want in a div and say data x-ray HTML, and it will provide the pre-tag for you without needing to duplicate that code anymore. So I can show you. All I had to do was add for like the info portal tag, div.xray.html, and now I can look at this at the site. And I made it white because I also wanted to show you that if you add Prism, it has syntax highlighting. So I didn't have to duplicate this, add a pre-tag, add a code, escape everything. I could just wrap it in a div, and this simple JS that I've loaded within the site gave me the code demo that somebody can then just copy and paste. And X-Ray HTML and Prism is for the syntax highlighting if you want it. Okay. Demo which I gave. Now, we need to think about maintaining the style guide. And it's, again, it's not something easy to do. I have some advice. Make it easy to maintain by having it placed within the site and having it load the actual site styles, because people will go to the site and they will use, especially editors, if you give them components that they can use, they will frequently go to the site and see what elements we have, and then they will just use it with TinyMCA or add it whenever they need it. And make it a habit of enforcing the style guide upgrade every time there's a feature added. You know, you add a feature, you add a new theming component, add it there. If you don't add it when it's developed, it's going to be really hard for you to add it afterwards. And you can always look for ways of automating the style guide through style guide generators. Here are some further readings for style guides, especially styleguides.io is a website which is crazy in detail with style guides. They have not only frameworks, but articles, books, podcasts. If you want to know and see how people are writing style guides, this is a great site to get more information. So after you made the style guide, you need to think of documenting it even further, or like your theme, with comments. And here I'm giving specifically a CSS example. If you're making a change or something like that and you need to fix something, you need to document it, and you need to let the user know, okay, why the change you made was there. And consider adding some simple comments, because whenever you're saving the portal CSS, if you add save compression, those comments will not be there. But when the developer comes and they're wondering why you made this, sometimes even like a git blame or 7a blame will not give them the full picture of why some code was added there. And consider adding an href to the site where that code was written, because sometimes you can look around and you're thinking, I don't know why this was added there, and having a page where that change is visible will make a big difference for them. So now that we've documented our theme, we need to think of, and we've optimized it, we need to think of how we can monitor for this performance. And we need to monitor for regressions. There are many tools that you can use. I was thinking of automating performance tests and regression that you might do with like Travis or Jenkins, whatever you might be using whenever you're testing. One tool that you can use, PSI, it's the same as the page index, but it's a command line program, and you can pass like a threshold, and it has several formats which you can integrate like with Travis or Drone.io or Jenkins, and you could make a test just like you test your Python. You could test if some of the changes that you made affect your score, and if it does, you should fail that build. Fantomas is again the library that I showed you that give you many performance aspects. There's also a Python package, which I really like, because once you load your site, you can make assertions, and like you can have unit tests about the performance of the site, and it might be a lot more familiar to use something like this rather than, I don't know, like a command line tool. And then you can also think of adding to your stack something like run performance budget, and you should check it out. It's what if you look at this link, basically they hooked it up, so whenever a pull request was done, it was checking the performance metrics, and if it was breaking the performance, the pull request failed, and then people knew not to add it to the site. So final advice, measure your site's performance periodically, keep your style guide up to date, consider setting a performance budget, like using plugins like Run Performance Budget, and focus on what matters the most to your users. I have some further reading. I recommend, if you are interested in really getting more performance out of your theme, CSS, check out the slides from Adi Osmani, a bunch of tools, many advice, some of them like I gave here, but in a lot more detail. And consider reading articles like this one, redefining the way we structure our CSS at Trello. At one point, a lot of big companies started sharing the way they write CSS and the way they structure it. Consider reading what other big companies are doing and see if you can pick up any patterns that you can use to make your site more maintainable and performant. So if you visit this last link, it will give you links to the way GitHub styles and Yelp and many other really big companies. That's it. If you have any questions, 1 minute and 50 seconds. Just a second.
Yeah, my question is about CSS optimizations. You mentioned that we have a linter, so we can know what's wrong with our CSS, but does it worth the effort? Did you measure how much it improves the performance to improve the CSS?
If you're asking if adhering to these advices actually improve performance, well, yes, it does, because first of all, they're really strict about how they want you to style. They don't want you to use many selectors. They want to use as few as possible. And not only does it help with performance, but it helps with maintenance, because you avoid having to write these crazy selectors to overwrite some other selectors. For instance, in Sunburst, we have like content they hover important or something like that, because they wanted to style the I don't know what link on the menu on the edit bar, and they wanted to keep that. We had to write like so much CSS to go around that. And if you're listening to them, if you avoid the importance, if you avoid those seven selectors, you know, first of all, it's more maintainable. If the structure changes, you know, you're still targeting those classes. You're not caring about what's around it. Yes, I definitely think it's worth it. GitHub has it. What they use like a style guide generator, something like that. But all of them are in the site. Like, look at GitHub; it's in the site. Code of America. If you look, the technology will differ. Like, many of them prefer to make it with jkill, make a static site with CSS that is compiled from the site. But it's always in the...
Wouldn't there be a danger if you include the style guide in your site?
Because if you update your website and you make a change in your CSS, then that automatically reflects in your style guide.
Well, first of all, they prefix. Whenever you're thinking, if you have some styles that really affect only the style guide, first of all, you can load them only in the style guide page. I mean, you have the CSS slot, and you can easily load. And second of all, you can prefix that CSS, you know, like, I don't know, style something or S something. And that way, it won't clash with the site styling.
OK, thank you.
You're welcome. OK, and I finished on time. Great, thank you.